Welcome. Tonight we answer the question, what makes a game a game? On episode 245 of the Origins nominated Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
Deanna picked our topic tonight, which has us talking about what defines a game according to us. From here, we share what games we've been playing lately, including Mare Nostrum Empires, Robot Quest Arena, and first plays of both Sentinels of Earth Prime and Words of a Feather. We've then got some big announcements, including our first ever Origins meetup, a little award we've been nominated for, and some upcoming local events. We finish up with two reviews, Robot Quest Arena from Wise Wizard Games, followed by Cytosis, a cell biology board game from Genius Games.
Before we get to all that, some introductions. I'm Sean, your host, and here with me we have the Bellhop Web Sorcerer herself, Deanna.
Hello to all my fellow cardboard connoisseurs out there.
And the Tabletop Bellhop himself, Mo T.
I am Mo Tuzano, the Tabletop Bellhop, your cardboard concierge, helping you make your game nights better.
This episode brought to you in part by our Patreon patrons and our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild. Show up Wednesday nights at 8 p.m. Eastern at twitch.tv/tabletopbellhop to watch us record this podcast live, though not next week, as we will be at Origins Game Fair in Columbus, Ohio.
You can find detailed show notes for this episode at tabletopbellhop.com, episode 245. That's 245. Links may be affiliate links, which cost you nothing but support us.
Also, the games we talk about tonight may have been provided by publishers as review copies.
The Tabletop Bellhop is here to answer your gaming and game night questions.
So tonight's question actually comes by way of Deanna. Deanna is the one that came up with our topic tonight, so I'm going to hand things over to her to get us started.
Well, recently over on Instagram, we were asked the question, do you consider Farkle a real game? And my first thought was, now, that's a silly question. I mean, I can answer that one pretty quickly. Mm-hmm. And the answer is yes, by the way, Farkle is a real game. But it started me thinking, like it stuck in my head and I found myself still thinking about it again, like a day or two later. Is Farkle a real game? And see, the problem I have with this question is the phrase real game, which implies that some games are real and others aren't. So I thought it would be an interesting discussion. Sure. Mo, what's the Bellhop's first law?
Of course, the first law is the best game in your collections are the ones that actually get to the table, the ones that get played. It doesn't matter how fancy they are, how clever the mechanics are, how awesome the miniatures are, how well-known the designer is, whose name's on the box. What matters the most is if the game gets to the table.
Right. There are no good games and bad games. There's just games. And the games that you're actually getting to the table and having a fun time playing, those are the best games out there.
Fair enough. I agree, but I do think... you said there are no good games and bad games, and I agree. Every game has its place, but I will say I think there are good games and bad games for me or for you or for a specific game group or a specific demographic. That not every game is for everyone. We've said that many times, though, and that's an awesome thing. It's great that there are all these different games that appeal to different people, and I think that is fantastic. Now, because you don't like a game doesn't make it a bad game, and because I love a game doesn't mean it's a good game for you. Games are awesome. The best game, of course, though, is that one you enjoy and you get played.
So we all agree Tapple After Dark is the best game.
that one's, I haven't had a chance to play that yet. We'll have to try that out before we know for sure. That one was just announced by our friends at the op. I do not plan on asking for a review copy of that one. I don't need After Dark games. Yes.
Okay, so, well, I think Farkle passes a test and is indeed a real game. It is not a game I want to be playing. It is not a game for me. That doesn't make it a bad game for other people. Pitchcar, right here behind me. You love that game. I never want to play that ever. Not unless there's a gun involved. I think there are some things out there that are called games that don't qualify as games. Well, some things that are being put in a box and called a game that are not in fact games.
I think it's interesting because one of the problems we run into is the popular definition of a game versus the actual definition of a game from the dictionary. Mm. So the dictionary definition of a game, the first definition of three is an activity providing entertainment or amusement, a pastime. And while our general definition doesn't include Candyland, that does.
Okay, so but we're talking specifically about tabletop games, board games, tabletop or tabletop games at the very least, right? Like by that definition, your definition would include me running outside and playing tag with my kids as a game. Yes. And it is, right? Well, it is. But it's a different type of game.
But it also includes Candyland, because it is an amusement or a pastime. It doesn't have what we consider things that are generally required in games, like active decisions. And, you know, the difference between Candyland and Yahtzee is you make choices in Yahtzee.
Right? Yes.
And we often consider that, and we've talked about it in the past, how that is a feature of what makes something a game in our minds.
Which we probably should have talked about so people know what we think is a game before saying it doesn't fit our definition we haven't defined.
All right. Number one, as Sean just hinted at, players make choices, their choices affect the outcome of the game. I think a game needs player agency. Your actions and decisions have to matter in some fashion.
And I agree with that. I think you have to have a decision made for it to be considered a tabletop game, a board game.
And by that definition, Candyland doesn't fit the dictionary definition of a game.
See, the dictionary definition of a game would qualify, I watch TV would be a game. Because there's nothing there about it being a game at all.
No, because watching TV isn't an activity.
It's a pastime.
Well, I think watching TV and Candyland are probably on the same level. I mean, Candyland has its place. It's an activity for children to do to learn colors and numbers. But it is not a game because it is just entirely, you have no choices. And everything is just, you do the thing. You follow the path and do the thing from beginning to end. Snakes and Ladders has the same problem, right? Like, there's no... It's just do. And by that argument, though, I have actually had an argument about this with our eldest daughter. Gelatinous, I think, is not actually a game. It is an activity. An activity that she enjoys doing, and she likes it, and she brings it to Board Game Club, but I would say it's not a game because there are no choices. You're just rolling your dice, stacking your dice, rolling your dice, stacking your dice. It's left, right, center. Left, right, center is not a game.
See, I agree with that. The only thing I want to get across that I think is important here is we're not saying games are better than activities. We're not saying that activities don't have value. We're not saying Candyland doesn't have value. We're not saying you can't have fun with Gelatinous because we watched it happen. We're not trying to say games are better. We're just trying to fulfill that definition because we were asked, is this a game? Now, I'm totally confused because I don't see how Farkle isn't a game. That's what kind of confused me. I think the question probably was, is Farkle a good game or do you consider it a good game? But as worded, it said, is Farkle a game? And I'm like, yes. Because the second thing.
Is Farkle a real game? Which implies that there are
not real
lesser games out there. And I didn't, you know.
Yeah. And I think the real game goes to where we've talked about, you know, Candyland is not a real game, whereas Farkle is a real game.
Yeah,
I don't like that term real because, again, it implies real is better than unreal.
It does. It absolutely implies that. But we also get into the problem where, again, the dictionary definition indicates that Candyland and Farkle are both real games, whereas our definition of a game doesn't include Candyland.
We're throwing the dictionary out for the rest of the episode because I think we can all agree that we disagree with the game definition in the Webster's dictionary. Is not how I feel tabletop games. Okay, so let's narrow it down to tabletop games.
Okay, the next thing I'm going to throw in is, to me, a game has structure, has rules. It is a structured form of play where everyone at the table is following a set of guidelines or restrictions, and part of being able to be part of that game is following those. If you do something that doesn't follow those, you're now playing against the game or out of the game. To me, one of the main definitions, and here Candyland still fits. It is structured play with a set of sequences to follow. It is organized. There are limitations. I think to me, that's a bigger part of what makes a game, or as big a part as being able to make decisions.
No, I agree. That was one of the things I had written down was there are rules, and the game most likely includes a rule book or a sheet of paper explaining the rules. And if you follow the rules, the game works. Like, Rule 4 doesn't make rule number 2 irrelevant or impossible. And there's where I feel that some games are not games, because if the rules contradict themselves and the game is broken, that's not a game. So is He-Man the RPG a game?
It's a game.
You can't actually play it rules as written. It is busted. Or
I think it's still a game. It's just a broken game.
I mean, I don't think it's incomplete. So it's not a product. I think is the bigger problem with Masters of the Universe. Masters of the Universe is not a finished product.
But no, again, it's a product.
It's like selling you Monopoly without the money.
I know there are other games we've run into this on, and I couldn't think of them. The only other one that came to my mind was Lone Wolf and Cub, was a game that Mo had, or still has, I don't even know, when I first started dating him. And I remember I was like, oh my gosh, you have a Lone Wolf and Cub game. He's like, no, that's not a game. You can't actually play that. You can look at the art. Because it was broken. And back then we didn't have the internet to go find Narada and figure out how to fix it, right? So I'm like, a game where the rules literally make the game impossible to play is not a game.
To me, that's a broken game. The intent was there. There are supposed to be structure that works. It's all supposed to be there. It just someone's little baby, they didn't blind pay to play test, or there was an editing error, or there was a mistake made. To me, that's still a game. It's not a playable game, but to me, it's still a game.
Okay.
I don't know. I have a hard time saying, if you can't play it, how can that be a game?
It's not a good game. It's a broken game. Like, you have to qualify it.
Oh, I mean, by that definition, isn't Candyland a broken game? It's not a good game. It's
not broken. There's just no decisions.
You can follow the rules as written, and they work, and they make sense, and you get from point A to point Z in Candyland. So it is not a broken game. My concept is that a broken game is not a game. It doesn't qualify for a game if it's busted. And I mean truly busted.
And I mean the argument that some people would put forth, Ryan says the lack of agency in Candyland is a feature, not a bug. But I mean, the shuffling of the deck is the player interaction within Candyland.
Yeah, but you don't make any decisions. It's still missing that decision point. I think you need a decision point. The other thing I think games need, though, are stakes. This could be you win or you lose. Those are probably the most basic. But it could also be like accomplishing an objective or getting everyone on the same page. Or it could be the entire group. You could have two teams and one team completes a thing and the other doesn't. There are other ways you can break it down. It doesn't necessarily have to be win or lose, but there has to be some kind of stakes. And there are Candyland again wins. Like the only thing to me that's missing from Candyland is a decision point. Which, if people are going to argue a game, it's just, to me, not an interesting game. It's an educational tool. It's lots of other things. But by to me, I don't classify it as a game. I think it's a great tool. It's a learning opportunity. It's a piece of history. It's foundational. It drove other things. It's important. It just, to me, doesn't quite fit what I'd want to call a game. If someone said, let's sit down and play a game, I expect to have something where I'm making decisions. And those decisions matter.
I called out Candyland because everyone knows Candyland, and I know it's Sean's favorite game. But as a mom, I can say there are a lot of games that are put out for, you know, in the preschooler toddler set, there are a lot of games that are put out for kids that are not games.
Yes.
And I'm not going to make a list of them.
Ryan was asking if you can lose in Candyland. I'm like, technically, yes, because someone wins. Yeah. Someone gets to the end first, and they're declared.
So here's a question. So, I mean... Candyland's not a game. War, you know, the card game War, not a game. Under the exact same questions. So here's my question, though. If we take the game of life, there is one branching path in the game of life. If we take that branching path out, does it no longer be? Is it no longer a game?
I think there's other decision points between.
I haven't played that in a long time, but I think there's other decision points where you decide if you're going to act on a space that you land on.
Like, if I remember, there's points where you can take out a loan and it's optional.
I would have to think. My thoughts were it was one of those you have to do something, and if you don't have enough money, you have to take out a loan. But like, if you have a kid, you have a kid.
The answer is, if there's a decision point, yes. If there isn't, then no. Either way, whatever the actual rules are.
I know it's got a branching path, and you can choose path A and B, which gives it immediately makes it a game under this discussion. And I'm trying to remember whether or not if you take that branching path out, if
there's
you've
actually
lost
a couple
choice.
Branching paths in the original. I think there's two or three, but
I haven't played it in like 30 years. So
last one I played was the Star Wars version, so it was very different from the original.
I don't know. I think I pretty much hit the points I wanted to make. I don't think I won you over to my point of view. I figured at this point we could dip into what the chat room has to say about the topic, because I've been seeing some interesting stuff.
So again, Darkling Bite points out a game is an act that has an action to perform, and then there are at least basic concept or some rules or guidelines to follow. So that hits part of what I said. Like I said, I think there has to be guidelines, there has to be stakes, and there have to be decisions. I think to me, those are the three foundations of a game. I'm going to write a book on this or an essay. The three foundations of game designs to be a game. I'm not going to use the term real game. I won't use that term. Because again, that puts it on a plateau above activities. I won't even say you have to have a rule book, because we all learned how to play tag when we were kids. And that is very much a game that had rules. But I've never seen a tag rule book. Though the internet exists now, I'm sure there's a Wikipedia.
Well, there's a professional tag league, so there has to be.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, have to be. But I'm just again, saying, like, we learned plenty of games. Tabletop games.
Here's an interesting question that Roger poses that I think does actually impact this topic very strongly, and it impacts things we review. And that is, what is the difference between a puzzle and a game?
A puzzle has one solution. A game has multiple branching paths.
But I mean, a game. In a large portion of the games, the end result is you win. It's you win or you lose.
Okay. Then I would say a puzzle is a subset of games that has a single solution, a single endpoint.
So by that definition, you're saying all of those mystery games we play, like from Mysterious Package Co., they're not games, they're puzzles?
Or puzzles are a subset. We're saying puzzles are a subset of games. So they're a type of game.
The type of game. Which is why we review them on the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
Does that make a jigsaw puzzle a subset of a tabletop game?
There's no decision point. You can't do it wrong. It's a single path with no decision point. Whereas like a murder mystery or an escape room box, you're deciding what to manipulate, what to do. Oh, an escape box might also fit as just puzzle. But like murder mysteries, there usually are options. You have choices. You have ways to go, things to look at. Different ways you can get to that final answer. While there's one final answer, there might be different ways to get to it. Where a puzzle, the final answer is the completed puzzle.
So we're looking at the difference between a puzzle and a puzzle game, I think is what we're coming down on.
Yeah, I think you can't fail at a puzzle. I mean,
yes,
I guess you could start ramming the pieces in incorrectly, but like it's a predetermined set. Action, you're going to put these pieces together in this order to make this puzzle. Whereas when we play one of those mystery games, you end up sometimes following a dead end, going over here, thinking about this, and have to pull the pieces together to come up with an answer. That
Ryan makes an interesting comment where all games have a loss condition, but not always a win condition. So you can always lose, but there aren't always winners.
Dungeons and Dragons doesn't have a loss. Co-op games, yeah, some. I don't know, I guess Dungeons and Dragons, your whole party dies. That's why I was trying to allude to that there is a system for stakes, right? You have stakes in Dungeons and Dragons, but there is no way to win or lose Dungeons and Dragons. Well, technically, I can come up with lots of ways to lose Dungeons and Dragons, but those have to do with bad DMs and poorly designed games. Like, your character dying can be a loss condition in a role-playing game, but that's very D&D-specific thinking. I have played many games where that is not a loss condition.
Well, I mean, yes. I mean, we talk a lot about player elimination in general, in all forms of games these days.
Oh, there. Yeah. So Darkling Blight saying that they're a narrative shaped experience. Again, at stakes, as long as there's stakes in the role playing game. And to be fair, I've tried to play role playing games without stakes and I don't enjoy them. And to me, those are just improv experiences. Right. You can just be silly and it doesn't ruin the game. And once players realize that, like if you got the right group, you can tell a great story together. But that's true of any improv experience or improv. Like, I guess some improvs are probably games, but versus or storytelling or sitting around and pass the stick and all of that.
Yeah. I mean, if you look at something like theater games, which are improv games, those are actually competitive improv things, not cooperative improv systems like many modern, super modern, you know, hipster RPGs are. There is a difference because it's two teams competing in improv scenarios and not one group cooperating.
Farkle is a game. It fits all three requirements.
Again, I guess it's the real clarification.
Yeah, it's the real. Like, I don't consider Yahtzee a real game either, I'm sure.
And Gelatinous is not, so I can now cite this episode to win my argument with our child.
Yeah, but she might not agree with us anyway, seeing as she is 16.
And again, she can pull out the dictionary. So, because we have agreed that we are varying from the dictionary definition here. We have our own definition that is more narrow.
Has Board Game Geek defined game?
That's a good question. I did not look into that.
Their guideline is... Actually, this is kind of true. Kind of like porn. You know it when you see it, right? It's It's kind of true in a way for why it fits.
Is it a game? You'll know it when you see it. Is that the description?
Yeah, basically. Well, I that's what the summary was.
They don't have a straightforward definition at all. They have wisely, perhaps, avoided coming out and saying what is a game.
I will say all of those things we're claiming are not games are listed as games on BoardGameGeek. So if anything, they're going closer to the
dictionary definition. Yes.
The dictionary definition. And I got to say, thinking of it from that perspective, not that I'm going to totally change my mind here, but where else would you put gelatinous?
Again, it's a hobby activity. It's an activity.
Hobby activity. We need hobby geek.
It's an activity.
Activity geek.
Flipping a coin. There's no difference between flipping a coin competitively and playing gelatinous.
Flipping a coin competitive. What's the difference? Is that what you asked?
No, there is no.
There difference. Is none.
Yeah. That's, well, flipping a coin competitively, you no, there's winners and losers. Yeah.
Well, it's literally flipping.
It depends if there's betting involved, because then player. Well, as soon as you add betting, gelatinous is a game.
Flipping a coin
choices
involves manual decks and is therefore more of a game than gelatinous.
No, there's decks in gelatinous. You got to stack those dice. I've seen people fail at this.
There is no player agency in either one, though. So
I no. give it to you.
No, there isn't. Like I said, until you throw in betting. Like LCR, I'm like, okay, a lot of people say LCR is a game, and then you're like, oh, they're betting on it. Well, of course, then it's a game.
Well, yeah, then you're, the betting is the game, not
yes,
LCR. That's your game. That's the, you know, you can bet on pig racing, and is pig racing a game? I don't really think so, but the betting you're doing for it is.
Is a game we don't like to mention a game the way most people play it? It does.
I don't know how most people play it. According to the rules, it's a game. There's meaningful choices, and there's voting. There's lots of choices.
Yeah. If you ignore the rules in a game, you're off on your own, and you may or may not be, depending on how it's chosen. But and now a word from our sponsor.
Last week we talked about the marriage mix-up, the latest Holiday Hijinks game. This week we're going to call out an older one, actually the second one ever published, which was actually the first we played. With the 4th of July coming up, it's the perfect time to pick up The Independence Incident.
In The Independence Incident, you go on an hour-long puzzle hunt steeped in American history. It's the 4th of July, and a great treasure may be hiding somewhere near our nation's capital. Work together to piece together the clues, follow the trail, and let freedom ring.
Like all titles, The Holiday Hijinks, this is an escape room-style game in just 18 cards. You can pick up a copy direct from Grand Gamers Guild, where it's available in both print and PDF, on its own part and part of a bundle.
And remember, anytime you're shopping at Grand Gamers Guild, use our code BELLHOP to save 10%. And I will note the U.S. is nation's capital. I don't think there's anything hidden up in Ottawa.
No, please don't storm Ottawa. They tried that. It didn't really take.
Unless you got up early, by the time you were listening to this, we're probably on the road to Columbus, Ohio, and the 2024 Origins Game Fair.
Now, I know we've been talking this up for a bit now, but we recently found out that there is an even cooler reason for the three of us to head down to this great convention. And that's because we were somehow selected as a finalist for an Origins Award. Seriously, I still hasn't sunk in.
Yeah, we're flabbergasted. Specifically, we were nominated for Best Media Production.
Well, we had already talked about attending the ceremony, this cements it. If anyone else cares to attend, it's being held on Friday night, June 21st from 8 till 10 in the Short North Ballroom A.
So this is a huge honor for us. And thanks, huge thanks to the selection committee and whoever nominated us. You are awesome. Like, thank you so much. I doubt we have any chance of winning, but just getting nominated is huge. Like, I have had like friends and family members calling my house to say, oh my gosh, I heard the news. Like, this is awesome. So also welcome to any new folk who are checking us out for the first time because of the nomination.
Next up, we want to announce the first ever Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast Origins Meetup. We put out the call and we had enough people express interest. So we've decided to host an event at 8 p.m. on Thursday night. And that would be June 20th.
We will be meeting at Brewcadia. This is a very cool spot and hidden gem that is located directly above Barley's Brewing Company, and that's located just across the street from the convention center. Just push past all the people in line to eat at Barley's and head up the stairs and to the left. They have a ton of great craft beer and other drinks, great pizza by Ohio standards, and the best of all, free-to-play retro video games.
So the plan here is for nothing formal or special, just a meet and greet, hang out, chat over some drinks, maybe grab some food and play some classic games. Just a chance for people to show up, say hi, and hang out for a bit. Now, if you do plan on attending, please do both of us a favor and watch our social media accounts and our Discord just in case we need to make any last minute changes or something falls through.
And if you did RSVP to the email I sent out, I will send an email out as soon as we're trying to cement some reservations. So yeah. As soon as we have that in place, I will send out an email. Due to us being at Origins, we will not be recording a live show next week on June 19th. So our next show should be June 26th. And that's probably going to be a con recap episode.
So the other thing happening when we come back the day after that, if we are recording on the 26th, is the June 27th is our next Brews and Board Games event at the Walkerville Brewery. Free event runs from 5 p.m. till 9 p.m.
And then next to that, the next thing happening here in Windsor is The Summoning, an entertainment convention that's happening at St. Clair College on the 20th of July. There, we're going to be hosting their open gaming area. We're going to have a small game library on hand for people to play. But more importantly, I think for people, we are going to have the first Windsor Play to Win event, including great games. We know already, I'll hint at three, okay? Here's three. The newest Star Realms box set. This is Star Realms, but it's in like board game box size. Lost Ruins of Arnak, one of our favorite games of all time. And some new hotness for you with Wyrmspan.
You can find more info at start.gg/TSC24.
Now it's time for the Bellhop's Tabletop, where we talk about the games that we've been playing lately.
So first up, we have a five-player extreme game of Mare Nostrum Empires. Sometimes the Bellhop second law happens on your second play too, and you're probably possibly our third play. This is just ironic because we keep saying this game isn't that complicated. It's not as bad as it looks. Look, it's a 4X, but it makes perfect sense. It's really simple. It's just about collecting goods and trading them. But there are a lot of things going on and a lot of things in play, especially with the heroes and wonders. And it's really easy to miss something, forget something completely, or misinterpret something. And all three of these plagued our last play of Mare Nostrum Empires.
Right. No, the game is super easy, super simple, simple as 4X. Don't do this or that or the other thing.
Yeah. It and again, this one, it wasn't helped by the fact that it was my first play. And this is a game that definitely your first play is going to be rough. 100%. There are choices I regret throughout that game, looking back at it, but I didn't know any better at the time. So I did what I did and tried things out and learned the hard way. Even if there hadn't been extreme play on top of that, your first play, you're more than likely going to make some poor decisions.
Yeah.
All right, Mo, you should break down what we played extreme.
Okay, so first, the one that ended the game badly was misinterpreting Cleopatra's special ability, which is you can substitute a gold for a good when purchasing something. So this is a game, I don't remember if we explained it last episode, but we didn't. You buy stuff by trading in different sets of goods or a full set of gold. Most things in the game cost three, some cost six. So when you're playing six, it has to be six different resources or six coins. Well, with Cleopatra, you can sub one resource for a coin, or when paying coins, you can substitute one coin for a resource. And well, the problem was the iconography for this shows two goods and a coin, and then two coins and a good. Well, my daughter interpreted this to mean that she could trade one or two coins instead of goods, which isn't the same and really affects one of the end game conditions, which is build the pyramids, which requires 12 different goods when there's only 13 goods. Well, she thought she could do it with 10, and I actually thought she could as well because of how she described what she thought Cleopatra did. So that was just a matter of read your ability better, read the reference card.
I think the first time we played the game, we actually got that part right. It's just that we let Gwen run with it this play, and then you had reiterated it to her. Oh, don't forget, you only need to get 10 to win because you're Cleopatra. So, I mean, you can't. Yeah.
I don't blame her for thinking that. It was the not referencing the thing and going, oh, wait, no, I can't exchange two. That was the part that was wrong. You can't swap two gold for two goods. It's you can swap one good in when you're paying gold. It's so there was that. Sean had a character who produced military units for free for occupied cities. And you would assume that probably happens in the build phase, but it doesn't. It happens in the actual movement and warfare phase. So the first time it should have happened, we got the timing wrong on that and like completely missed it, which would have completely changed like enough of the game that we couldn't back up.
Now, the card's actually really clear on that one, though. But we just we were again, assuming
that was to me that,
that
was,
it would go.
To me, that was my first play mistake. I don't even consider that necessarily playing extreme. I didn't do something that I could have done. I didn't do anything wrong. But it was the, I didn't take an action that was available to me.
I think it was the very small text on the reference card that said what phase it happened was not clear enough, like obvious enough.
Yeah, I wasn't even considering that's, the fact that I needed to look for that.
Right. Where that's where the extreme play, I think, came in. Not that. It was the fact that we missed that it happened in a phase where you normally don't produce units. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to think of what the other one was. Do you remember what the third one was?
Why well, actually list them?
Yeah, I don't remember what the third one was. There was again. I know I made mistakes in play, but not in.
I think your mom missed something. Rome's attacking power. Sorry, I don't remember.
No, I had a horrible headache that night and I don't remember, which is why I made you list them off. I'm like, what did we screw up on that game?
I think it's definitely worth playing again. Again, that first experience, I knew it was, 4X games. Even the easy 4X games are still 4X games. And there's a lot to take in and you've got a lot of options. You know, that's one of the interesting things about this game is you are not in any way short of possible things you could do.
Yeah.
And you know, it's all about, you know, choosing the best. Knowing all the other factions and what their strengths and weaknesses are and things like that. There's a lot to take in, even if the game itself again plays reasonably quote unquote simply.
I dig it. I still enjoyed it. This was I liked the second play better for the first than the first, for those of us who had played it before. It let me repeat and reinforce some things we had trouble with the first time for the new players. So there was some stuff that we stumbled over the first game that I think played better. For one, people weren't getting confused on the trading in resources, which the first time we played, people weren't quite getting the sets right. And they were trying to do three of a kind. And I think I was able to explain that part much clearer. As well as the who gets to do what. And we are also way better at adjusting the tracks this time than we were the first time around. So honestly, I just think this one's going to keep getting better the more we play it. We'll see. We'll have to keep a record. We can start a pot on how many games we'll play before we play a full game without making a single rule mistake or missing an obvious rule that we're. I think by missing, it's the you want to back things up, missing something to the extent you want to back things up and you can't.
Well, and that's that's multiple things I did, because the other thing I did wrong in my first trading session was I had thought that the coin was a resource, so that I needed a bunch of groups of three resources. So I thought nine different resources when actually I had eight different resources
and one coin
and a coin.
And the one big thing we learned is wait, verify your win condition. Don't start cleaning up.
Yes.
That's what my mom screwed up. She cleaned up the board as soon as we said Gwen won and Gwen didn't actually win. We quickly realized that she had interpreted the Cleopatra rule wrong and we would have continued playing. But at that point, the game had been wiped enough that we were like, nobody wins this game.
Yeah.
We all lose together.
Well, she should know better. I didn't even get a picture. I need a picture of the finished board. That's the unwritten rule that was broken. I'll have a talk with her. All right. Up next, we played 4-player Robot Quest Arena, which I'm still really digging. I love the speed of this game. I like how fast and furious it is. I like the feel of this. This game does what it's supposed to do. Like it's definitely winning me over for that fast battle in an arena game. Now, we're reviewing this one in just a bit, actually, just after this segment. Our next segment, we'll be doing a full detailed review of Robot Quest Arena. So I'm going to save the rest of my thoughts for then. Do you two have anything you want to add before we get to the review?
I like it more the more I play it. So, I was kind of lukewarm on it at first, and now I'm up to...
I mean, deck building battler is really kind of in my sweet spot. So I'm still there with it, there for it.
All right, next. Something brand new from our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild. Something you'll be able to pick up at Origins at booth 1233. If you go, tell them Mo sent you or the Tabletop Bellhop. I have no idea if you're going to get anything for that, but Mark keeps telling me to tell people to tell him. So I have a feeling it might be worth mentioning our name. And make sure you say the Origins nominated. No. Anyway, so the game is Words of a Feather, a box that's behind me that is too tall to fit in a Kallax standing up. What I really should have done is hung it on the wall behind us, because that's what it's designed to do. This is a word association game that to me kind of feels like a next step or in the same family as Codenames. And maybe even a little bit of Chameleon there, because this is a word association game. So what happens in this game is you have five words in front of you, randomly generated. Sorry, it sounds digital. Randomly drawn from a deck, and you're going to pick two of those. Then you're going to come up with a third word in your head that you hope the combination of those three will get everyone to guess your secret word. And you're going to write the secret word down on your dry erase board. Then everyone else writes down what they think your secret word is. And then they can also bet up to two of their points. Then everyone reveals. The active player gets 1 point per player that matches them. Every other player gets 1 point if anyone else matches them. That's important, because you don't have to match the active player. If you match anyone else at the table, you get a point, which I really like that rule. Every player who bets doubles their bet if they made a match with anyone again. So it's not necessarily about making a connection with the player who's coming up with the secret word. It just has to be someone else on the table. First player to a set number of points wins. It's higher the more people you're playing with. And that's pretty much the whole game. I just taught you right there.
This game is group medium with betting.
Yeah, the medium, except there's three things. You're adding a third thing in. If it was only two words, it'd definitely be medium. It'd be very similar to medium. That does fit, though, that type of game.
Yeah, it's not really my sort of game. I didn't really connect with it, but I know there are groups out there that love this kind of game. And when you combine, the solid play for that style of game combined with the beautiful component quality that makes it really stand out on the table, this could be a great game for some people. Just I wasn't one of them.
Yeah, part of this game baffles me, right? Because it's over the top, overproduced, great looking table presence for no real reason. Like it even comes with a ceramic bowl, like an even nicer ceramic bowl than the one in Sushi Go, which again, now that's two games we played this year that came with ceramic bowls. Is this the new trend in board game? Is the new hot component is giving you a ceramic bowl? I'm all for it. Sure, why not? But besides the ceramic bowl, you lay these cards out. They kind of look like peacock feathers in circles, right? And you keep going around and around, four concentric circles with the bowl in the middle with these really colorful aquarium, the spiky, I don't know what you call them, crystals, aquarium crystals. But all of that is just for looks. None of it impacts the game at all. There is no reason you're not just drawing cards off the top of the deck. When you finish your turn, you pluck two feathers, but the feathers are face down. Like you're not getting a choice on what to pick. I just find it really odd, because the big selling point of this game is what it looks like. And I wasn't kidding. The box is designed to hang on your game room wall. It's not supposed to go on a shelf. It's got a wall hanger on the back. And it confuses me. I'm like, I don't know. Like, was it just because it was a big successful Kickstarter? Like, was that it? We're just trying to wow people with the looks.
I mean, yeah, this is easily the prettiest, biggest table presence, most elaborate looking word game I've ever seen. Okay, like for like a simple party game, and it takes up a lot of table space too. And again, there's no reason for it. You could just go, accordion fold. Oop, we got a deck. We're done. It only takes up tiny, tiny footprint, right? It's very pretty in a very like Art Deco kind of vibe, and the box actually hangs on the wall very well. Like Mo actually tossed it up on the wall in our dining room, and I'm like, well, it's sitting there very nicely, and they didn't put any words on three sides or any box information, and it's kind of like brushed gold and kind of looks like it belongs on a wall. And I'm like, yeah, I guess. I get very nervous that it's hanging on a wall and has a ceramic dish in it. I just keep thinking that's going to end badly, but it hasn't.
Yeah, I mean, the price point's not bad. You know, considering that you've got a ceramic bowl, you've got 65 cards and great art, lots of things. I think the $35 price point isn't outrageous. Could they have made it cheaper if they cheaped out on all the components? Yes, but they would have been cheaping out on all the components. So, you know, choices were made. And $35 for a good solid party game with a lot of replayability isn't.
We're not big party gamers, right? I thought the game was smart. It did a neat thing. The whole adding a word and the fact you don't have to match with the person who's guessing, like, it did a neat thing. It's got that Codenames vibe, right? Everyone's giving one word clues. And it's got that kind of puzzle, and it's got the thing where, you know, how well you know each other people at the table is going to matter. And you get that talk afterwards, like, why did you say this? Why did you give this clue, not that? So it has all the stuff I like in party games. But what I need to do is get this one out to our public play events, right? Like our next Walkerville Brewery event. I want to see if that aesthetic really does draw people in, right? Like, are we just jaded hobby gamers with too much focus on the actual mechanics? And not going, oh my God, look at the pretty cards. Look at the bowl. Look how awesome this game looks, right? Like, I've gotten in trouble enough times by forgetting to explain the theme of a game before getting right to the mechanics, right? Not that they explain why you're plucking feathers. So I don't know if the theme here matters other than it looks like a peacock. But I have a feeling like if we put this out on one of those octagonal tables that's kind of standing with the bar stools around it, we'll see. Maybe people will flock to it.
I gotta tell you, my uncle had peacocks on his farm. You do not pluck their feathers. You wait for them to drift to the ground and then go collect them. No, I cannot bet against you on that because I think it is going to draw people in. It's a very pretty looking game.
Yeah. And there's, again, a lot of people love this style of game. So combine that with that look and there may be a real winner here, even if it didn't wow us.
And of course, fuel review coming eventually. We obviously need some more plays. I want to play with a big group too. We played with four players, plays up to eight. I want to see if it plays better with eight. Get eight people out there. You're going to make matches a lot more often. There's probably going to be more discussion. We'll see. Next, first play again, off the pile of shame, Sentinels of Earth Prime. This is the result of a collaboration between Greater Than Games and Green Ronin, and is the Mutants and Masterminds version of Sentinels of the Multiverse. And from what I understand, based on what I've seen from other people and other reviews, Board Game Geek comments and so on, this is kind of like the precursor to the definitive edition of Sentinels of the Multiverse. It came out in between the second edition of Sentinels of the Multiverse and the new definitive edition. So it's got some of the stuff from Sentinels.
This is a very solid game. I think the difference between the characters involved was really a standout feature. We just basically randomly picked three of the heroes and they did just utterly different gameplay, not even slightly the same.
So I had played the original, played it a couple of times, a friend's copy. I was a little fiddly. I found there was a little bit too much to track, a little too many tokens, and there were counters everywhere. I jumped in the second edition, and I actually still own my second edition of Sentinels with, I think I picked up two of the things. I didn't go all the way to the end. I didn't follow the whole story arc, but I did buy a couple expansions for it, and I did find it a bit better. Now, this version, I did find much smoother. There's a little less reliance on tokens. There's a little less things to track, and I really liked it. And like Sean said, like, the asymmetry here is above and beyond, honestly. Like, and the discovery, we did not look through our decks first. We just started playing. And that discovery of, oh, I am building momentum cards. I am got a lot of momentum cards. I bet you I'm going to have a way to throw away momentum cards. Oh, I'm a speedster. Okay. Yep. I am definitely building up momentum. Oh, there it is. 18 damage to eight different things in play. Yep. That's what this character is all about. Meanwhile, Sean was playing a very different character. And our daughter Gwen was like, okay, why do I have all these abilities to go through my deck? Why can I grab my equipment? Oh, wait, I can start burning my equipment to do these cool things. And I actually really enjoy the discovery of playing a character for the first time in Sentinels, and that carried over to this Mutants and Masterminds version.
I think what was really nice for me, and I am someone who generally likes to go through the decks. If you give me a Lorcana deck, I'm going to want to flip through it so that I have an idea of how to play that deck and how it's going to work. I don't generally work well with, okay, well, we'll just flip a card and see what happens. Whereas because of the superhero theme, I had Captain Thunder. And as soon as I grabbed the character and looked at the art on the character, you know, card, I'm like, okay, I know what I'm doing here. I know who Captain Thunder is because he is a comic book, you know, trope for basically. And you know, Mo was playing the speedster, and it was the speedster trope. It was, you know, you run real fast and then you throw lightning sort of thing. And Gwen was playing, you know, that sort of magical enchanting warrior where they kind of, you know, recycle through all of their swords and armor and things magically. And so even though I didn't look through my deck, I knew what I was getting into real fast because it followed that character's concept through very, very well.
Greater Than Games, I feel bad. I don't have the designer's name in front of me. I wish I did. Because props to whoever came up with the original idea for Sentinels and Multiverse. Just flows and feels right, right? It's that cooperative game where the players go, the villain goes, the players go, the villain goes. But it's different. Like here, the villain does something terrible, right? There's a villainous plot. It starts with the villain doing something terrible. Then the heroes respond to it and try to do something about it. And then what I really like in Sentinels is they threw in the environment, which is something a lot of supers games, to me, forget. They get the heroes and the villains, but they forget how important it is where you're fighting. And I love that about this game. And you rinse and repeat, right? The villain does something terrible. The heroes react. The environment comes into play. The villain does something terrible. You react. And it just works really well. And it flows well because of the whole rule that you can only play one card a turn. And you can only use one power a turn. So you kind of slowly build up your character abilities. And the way the villain environmental cards enter play also kind of gives that escalation feel, which is the other thing I think that's really important to a supers game, is that it starts off small and then just keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger.
So the original designers were Christopher Bedell, Paul Bender, and Adam Ribotaro.
Yeah, this game went well. A little too well. I don't know if we were just really good. We're really good at cooperating. We've all played a lot of games. Well, Gwen was playing. Gwen is an experienced gamer, but she hasn't played nearly the number of games I have. But it was a little easy. Now, we did use level one heroes and the level one villain, so that could have been it. Maybe it's meant to be more of an intro. I do remember the original game being very punishing, so maybe over the years they went, we got to put kind of an intro fight in here. I don't know. If we didn't mess something up, maybe we'll just jump to the advanced villain rules sooner rather than later. But honestly, I just want to play more. I've been trying to get this to the table for a while and show Sean how good Sentinels can be, because we did play a game of Sentinels in the past that didn't go so well. But I tried to play with a bunch of promo decks that really did not combo well together. My only decision now is, like, do I want to play the speedster again? And again, I didn't note down the character name. Johnny Rocket or something like that. Something Rocket. Do I want to keep playing them to really get to know their deck and get really good with them? Or do I want to play around and see what other heroes there are?
I think we probably both played well, but also it was very much an introductory game, probably for very intro players. And even though, you know, Gwen hasn't played as many games, she is a gamer and she understands the deck, the concept of it. And that's very much a, you know, this is your first superhero card, you know, tabletop game sort of thing, I think is what that was.
Yeah. And it also just could have been real luck that I happened to have a character that could bury the opponent's cards. And we were facing a villain who leveled up once they get so many cards in play. Like, that could have been it, right? Like, because that is something that happens in Sentinels. Certain combinations are definitely better than others against certain villains, which is part of exploring the game. And I think we might have got lucky on that account as well. I don't know. We'll try again.
I would be curious to know how much of the fun of the game was the exploration factor and if it's going to get stale once you know all the characters.
That's true, but then they give you a lot of characters. So it would take us a while, more than our usual. We're going to try this game at least 5 times to deep dive that far. So I've got to say, in that aspect, for the usual game group who only plays games, you know, at most 5 times, you're going to get to do that exploring every time for a while.
I actually got in a few games of Zensu, because we have to mention Zensu. I am contractually obligated to mention Zensu in every episode. No. I started playing it with our youngest daughter, like, every day. I'm trying to fit in one game a day, and we did it for 4 days in a row, but then we didn't do it today. was like, oh, we can just set up a game of Zensu and do it while I'm cooking dinner. And I'll, like, you know, while I'm prepping dinner, I'll do turns in between because it's like, you know, dump it out on the table and play it really quick. So I love Zensu, the end.
And that's all we've been playing lately. What have you been up to? What games hit your table this past week? Love to hear about it in the comments or tag us on social media where we can be found everywhere as Tabletop Bellhop, one word.
Robot Quest Arena is a fast and furious deck-building game of robot battles that comes from a partnership between Perfect Day Games and Wise Wizard Games, who we have to thank for hooking us up with a review copy.
This 2-4-player card-driven robot combat game comes from the team of Robert Dougherty, CJ Monahan, and Paul Waite.
Battles are fast and furious and over pretty quickly, with games taking about an hour tops, quicker with less players.
Now, we couldn't find a recommended age for this game, but we would say it's very family friendly and probably great for kids. So there is reading involved, so you can't go too young, and there are tiny little cubes, so be aware of that.
So Robot Quest Arena has a bit of a Pokemon vibe going on. You are kids on the island of Rivet, and you each have your own pet robot, which you battle each other in the arena, or the robots battle each other. Now, each team has a special ability, and it's up to the players to decide how to best improve their bots through deck building. Use energy to move and purchase new cards, move around the battlefield and push other bots, taking full advantage of the variable terrain tiles, and use an array of silly melee and ranged weapons to KO your opponents. Each point of damage done is a point for you. And don't worry, if your bot goes down, it just respawns next turn.
The components in Robot Quest Arena are fantastic. I mean, fantastic. This game features, like, the cutest chunky plastic robots that remind us of, like, Nintendo Amiibos or Infinity figures. They're full color. They look awesome. And there's a very clear board with spots to store everything, though the board is a bit big. The card art's great. The iconography is excellent. The rulebook is very clear and concise. It's a win all around.
Yeah, if we had to complain about anything component-wise, it would be the size of the board. Now, while it's not ridiculous, we would have preferred just the arena. That way you can arrange the rest of the stuff, the cards, the health tokens, however you want, and optimize your play area and shrink it down on table space better. Now, that said, especially with newer, younger gamers, having a place for everything can be a bonus.
So you start a game of Robot Quest Arena by placing that big board out, shuffling the shop deck, and putting out an initial 6-card market. Placing the Advanced Battery, Heavy Hammer, and Rivet Gun cards at the bottom of the shop. These are 3 cards that are always available to purchase. Set up the board according to the rulebook, or honestly, however you wish, making sure to include enough spawn points for your players. Make piles of health markers at the bottom of the arena. Note the amount of blue cubes is based on your player count.
Everyone picks a bot and takes the appropriate player board. Keep the bot off the board for now, but fill in the health spots on your player board with 1 blue cube, followed by a number of red cubes. It's based on how many wrenches are showing on your player board.
Now everyone gets a starter deck of 10 cards with 8 batteries, 1 hammer, and 1 jump jet card. These get shuffled and everyone draws 5 cards.
So at the start of your turn, if your bot isn't on the map, refill their health, which you obviously don't have to do the first turn, and pick a spawn point to start on. Then play cards to do stuff, right? It's a deck builder. Now, movement is orthogonal and is blocked by obstacles and other bots. Some cards provide movement, just straight up movement points that have to be used for movement. But the majority of your movement will be generated by spending energy, which comes from cards like batteries. 1 point of energy per square on the board moved. When moving, you can also push another bot for 2 energy. And if you push that bot into something, it takes damage. And if you push 2 bots into each other, they both take damage.
So while you're going to need energy to move, you're also going to want to use it to buy new cards. Each card in the shop has a cost and is added to your discard pile once it's bought. There are, of course, a wide range of cards, including ways to heal and ways to purge your deck, a variety of new ways to move, energy generation, and of course, a slew of very silly weapons.
Weapons are either melee or ranged, with range being counted as square rings radiating from your bot, while melee is just orthogonally connected. Line of sight is required for most ranged weapons, and this is calculated from the center of your square to the center of the target square. Bots and obstacles block line of sight.
To make things interesting, the arena can be filled with a variety of different terrain tiles. There are walls that are just obstacles, computer terminals that let you draw and discard cards, the scrap heap that lets you purge cards from your deck, the potentially deadly trash compactor, and more.
Every time you damage an opponent, you collect their health tokens and they become your victory points. Red cubes are worth 1 point each, but the blue cubes, which are only awarded when you KO a bot, are worth 2. You also earn victory points by being in the middle 9 squares of the board at the start of your turn and through some shop cards.
Remember how each time you respawn, you refill your health? Well, the game ends as soon as someone tries to respawn, but there are no more blue cubes left. At that point, people count up their points, and the bot with the most points wins.
So Robot Quest Arena is a deck-building card game, and that means it features exception-based rules, where the cards can override pretty much anything we just said. For example, Jump Jets let you move over obstacles or other bots. Crate, which is the blue bot, costs an extra energy to push. Lasers shoot through things and don't require line of sight, and so on.
And when you're playing with two players, each player controls two robots with one single personal deck. Each card played, you decide which robot it's going to affect with your energy, and your movement is shared between the two robots.
There are also rules for team play, where every time your teammate loses health, you also lose one victory point, and it's the team with the most points between both members that wins the match.
So for our thoughts, I want to start off with just how eye-catching this game is. A big part of this is the big plastic full-color miniatures, but that's not it. It's just the overall bright cartoon aspect of the entire game. The icons chosen, the colors used, the look of the characters. There's just something inviting about this game.
So one thing I want to point out, and this is going back to Mo's mention earlier of the Pokemon vibe. It's interesting because in some ways, this game is nothing like Pokemon. Yet it still gives that vibe as the graphics, the theme, and even having an associated theme song really try to give that Pokemon vibe. The game, outside of the theming, really doesn't have any Pokemon aspects, though.
Well, it's not Pokemon the card game. It's giving off vibes of Pokemon the cartoon series, really.
Yeah.
It's kind of got that. And it's visually, the thing with this game is it's just so visually cohesive. Like, everything goes together beautifully, and it looks great on the table, and it looks very eye-catching, and it just looks fun.
Now, the next highlight for me is just how quick the game plays, and possibly more so, how much back and forth there is in a match. Now, when I first heard robot battle deck building, I was expecting a program movement game, something like Robo Rally. And that's not this. This is fast and furious battle, kind of like a Super Smash Brothers, where bots are moving all over the place and getting knocked out left and right, only to respawn, come back, and knock someone else out themselves. There are a lot of knockouts in this game. And once people have started to get some of the more expensive weapon upgrades, there's a lot of one-shot kills.
Yeah, I was surprised by how quickly this ramped up to where we were running in, KO, run out. Now you run in and KO, run out as, you know, maybe 2-shot kills. Very infrequently are we going further than that, unless it's at the very beginning of the game, right? So that ramp up there, I was surprised by that before we actually sat down and played it.
Yeah, you quickly learn to get over your concern about being knocked out and instead just try to do more damage on your way to the scrapyard. These aren't high-end robots. These are easily rebuilt and repaired by kids. So you don't have to be concerned that a KO is any sort of great loss. They're just patching on whatever they find in the scrapyard.
And I think they nailed it with the game length here as well. Like Deanna said, it wraps up quickly, but it ends right when you picked up a couple really cool expensive cards and maybe gotten to use them once or twice. You did the cool thing once or twice and like, oh, the battle's over. I think if it went any longer, that thrill of upgrading, that ability to pull something off, something fancy and something neat would be lost if you just kept upgrading your deck. Plus, I have a feeling you'd start feeling bloated and you get more annoyed at just drawing the weapons you bought the first couple rounds. You don't get that feel of, oh, my deck is just so full and bloated now. Where's that one thing I want?
No, I agree. Like, the timing on it is perfect. The game doesn't overstay its welcome. And also, you're getting knocked out all the time, but it, as we've already kind of hinted at, it doesn't take you out of the game. There's no player elimination, and I love that aspect. No one's ever sitting there waiting for the round to wrap up.
So the escalation in cards, as you can afford more bigger cards, is really what sets the timing on this game. Once you're getting 7 or 8 energy every turn, the cards you can buy and the movement you're capable of really means that you're just trashing the other robots, sometimes even more than one if that timing works.
Yeah, I'm still waiting for a three-shot kill. We haven't seen one yet in our games. We've had two. We've had two in one turn. The other thing I really like is just how simple the game is, right? It doesn't get bogged down. You're just, you use points to move or buy cards. You use weapons to hurt each other and you use the terrain to your advantage. You're not worrying about things that are in some other robot battle games or arena games where you're worried about facing. You're not worrying about turning left or right. And there's no weird chain reactions to go off. And there's no complicated timing rules. Everything's just straightforward, simple, and easy to implement.
Yeah, like the timing, the line of sight, everything is just, it's kid level simple. Yeah. Well, without being too simplistic, like, because it doesn't feel dumbed down. It doesn't feel like, why am I playing this dumbed down game? But it's just smooth.
Yeah, simple doesn't mean it lacks anything. The range of cards and ways in which to use them and chain means more capable players can pull off some really nice turns, possibly most limiting by how much health the other players have left at the time.
Yeah, that was something we didn't really mention in the rule overview because we're being pretty high level, but like, bots don't have a lot of health. Like the majority of them, 3 out of 4 in the core game, only have 4 health, and overkill damage doesn't matter. So if you're doing at least 4, that bot's done. Now, we all already mentioned the board size as a minor complaint. Even if we didn't eliminate it, I wish the market board was a separate board. That way we can use it or not, depending on where we're playing. I do like that it's there. Like I said, playing with younger people, especially with the theme, the it looks like the audience for this game, and you probably want someone to know where to put everything, right? Like, where's this card go? Where's that card go? But if you were with a group of experienced deck builders, it's not where I would put the stuff. I would put the stuff you can always buy at the top of the board. I would have run the market in a straight line at the bottom. You know, I would have done things in a different order, and like all the health cubes would be in wooden bowls if you're playing at my place. So I would have liked that more variety if that board was at least separate, because then I can leave it in the box or I could just not put it out as needed.
Yeah, I agree. I like the ability to adapt it to table size and where people are sitting and stuff like that. I value that in a game, but I think having everything laid out very idiot-proof is kind of like what helps make this a very family weight game.
I think part of the problem is also that there is some dead space on the board, and I expect that was put in to pad the size to a standard printing size so that they could, they didn't have to do a fully custom cut. But that just goes a little bit further into making that whole thing feel so big on the table.
Now, we're not talking like, Marrakesh Hamburg big here either. It's not huge. It just feels bigger than it should be. But then the miniatures are bigger, too, and the spots are bigger. There's just something about the game that's just like big. Now, you all know I love asymmetry in games, and this game is good for it. Each bot is unique. Personally, though, I want each kid to be unique, right? You've got the Pokemon kind of thing going on, right? Like each character you're playing is a pair. You've got a hero and a bot. And I just think the game would have been cooler if each hero had an ability and each bot had an ability and you could mix and match.
So while I get where you're coming from, I personally think that's kind of unnecessary. The kids are set dressing. And I mean, even in Pokemon, the kids are supposed to be you. You're all the same. Everyone's the same. And it's your Pokemon monsters, or in this case, robots, that are the big differentiator in how you use them as opposed to what they are capable of.
Yeah, and I will say our kids, when one of them's only gazed upon the game and hasn't actually played it yet. But when they were checking out the game, they didn't want the kids to be heroes. All they were interested in was Robot Wars.
Yeah, my kids are a huge fan of Robot Wars and BattleBots. That's what they want to play. They don't care if they're kids. They want to be the kids. So I can see it. Like I said, it's a minor niggling thing. I always like more asymmetry. The more asymmetry you give me. Give me defaults. These can be the defaults, but then give me a way to swap out kids later. Plus, if anyone wants to complain about Sean calling all Pokemon traders the same, that's Sean@tabletopbellhop.com. Now, I think a good indication of how much we liked this game is the fact that all three of us got together at a local coffee shop and played the game 3 games in a row. The first time I brought it out. And the fact by the end of it, you had us online going to Wise Wizard's website going, oh, what expansions are there? Because I know when we were at Gamma Expo, we saw other bots. What are the other bots? We immediately wanted more. And I've got to say, there's a Pokemon aspect. We kind of want to collect them all.
Yeah, gotta catch them all. I gotta say, I think we would have played 4 or 5 times in a row if the coffee shop wasn't closing. True. So that's an indication there.
Yeah, I think the aside from that toyerific aspect, they really nailed the game length. And part of that as well, and this goes to the look as well as the game length and everything, is that this game was well play tested. And it was tweaked. Like, you can tell that a lot of work went into this game. It's not just pretty, but it's pretty and it is an effective game. What we don't know, because as much as we would like to collect them all, we haven't, how the available expansions might affect that and adjust that tightness of the game, because that's one of the things that we found is these expansions do add a lot to the game, or have the ability to add a lot to the game if you choose to include it.
Yeah, these expansions look awesome, right? Like, each new bot comes with a new character to play, a new mini, more health cubes, new map tiles, and a new set of rules. Each bot adds a new element to the game, which just looks really cool. Like, there's new sets of cards. One of them has events. Another one has movable terrain. There's all kinds of stuff. But I don't want to say more because we haven't tried any, though I want them. Seriously, the collector's urge here is it's bad.
Yeah, I was shocked that there was actual new rule sets coming with each robot. Just a cute robot and a player card with a little bit of asymmetry. I already would have been like lining up, okay, we need these. So the when I found out there was new rule sets, I was like, we must find these now. They have to.
Yeah, new rules, new cards, new tiles for the board. Mm-hmm. There's a lot in these expansions. You know, even though you're only getting one more robot.
So overall, we all enjoyed Robot Quest Arena. Everyone we played it with so far has enjoyed Robot Quest Arena. It's a great mashup of arena battle game and deck building card game. It looks fantastic. I've got to say their universe looks interesting enough. I have a feeling, I'm not sure if this is true, but I have a feeling there may be more coming in the Robot Quest Arena. Like, Robot Quest might be a whole thing. This is Robot Quest Arena. Maybe there's more Robot Quest games coming. The fact they, you know, hired a band and wrote a theme song for it might be it. But this on its own, without any of that, is a great family weight game that kids could enjoy on their own, but also a ton of fun for a group of deck building pros who have played deck builders going back to the original StarCraft.
Yeah, I think this is indeed a great family weight game. If you have younger kids and you are willing to sit down and play it with them, you are going to have a fun experience. For slightly older kids, they can be playing it on their own. And this is one that grownups are going to want to play on their own, too. So it's a, you know, solid.
Yeah, I could see if I were really getting into this with the family, not only are there 3D printed tiles that look fantastic, mm-hmm. to give you that, you know, the dimensionality to the spike traps and things. But also, I think that the board itself, you know, we were talking about the board being too big. You could probably get like an extra large mouse pad size neoprene mat that would just fit neatly in the box on its own without even having to roll it. And that would probably be enough to fit the actual combat section of the board. And you could do whatever you chose to do with all the rest of the components and cards.
Now, if you're looking for an arena battle game that gives you that fast and furious and silly kind of feel of games like Super Smash Bros., I think this is going to be a great game for you. There's been a few other games out there that tried to recreate that fast, furious, run and gun feel. This does it better than any others I've played.
And if, like me, you're a deck building fan, you should check this game out. It's using the mechanics you love to do something new and interesting that's worth trying. Robot Quest Arena evokes a rather different feel from most other deck building card games while holding on to a familiar mechanic.
Now, if you're looking for something like Mechs versus Minions or Robo Rally, but with deck building, that's not what this is. Honestly, it's what I thought this was going to be until I sat down and played it. Despite being card driven, you don't get any of that programmed movement feel at all. There's no worrying about having something mess up your planned route. And while there's some fun stuff on the board, it's not a puzzle. You're not trying to figure out how to best use the conveyor belts and the gears and get pushed the right way. Now, I will say it is highly possible if you do love that kind of game and you're looking for that kind of game, you may still enjoy this game, because I did. Just be aware that you're sitting down to play a quick, rapid battler, not any type of puzzle game.
And as quick as that, the battle is over. The crowd is heading out of the arena, and it's time we wrap up this Robot Quest Arena review.
You all know how much I love deck building games, and I thought this one was pretty cool. What's the newest deck building game you've played? I'd love to hear all about it in the comments.
Now, I like deck builders too, but I also like coffee. You can top us up by heading to ko-fi.com/tabletopbell.
all educational games are boring, right? Well, this is no longer true, as we're about to explain in Cytosis, a cell biology board game review.
Cytosis, a cell biology board game, which I'm just going to call Cytosis from now on, and I think the other two of us are going to join me in that. We're just going to call it Cytosis, comes from the folk at Genius Games. We do have to thank for providing us with a review copy. Now, the goal of Genius Games is to produce educational games that are actually fun and that will appeal to modern board game audiences. And honestly, I'll say right here, they nailed it with Cytosis.
Cytosis was designed by John Cuvio and features additional art by Tom's Bogues. It plays 2 to 5 players with games taking under 2 hours, most of ours being close to 1.5 hours, except for our first couple of plays.
So Genius Games lists this game as being ages 10 plus, which seems like a good fit, as that's around the age you start taking and learning about cells in school, although that may vary by district.
Yeah, we specifically requested this game because Genevieve, our daughter, was currently taking cell biology at the time. Though that was plant cells, and this is animal cells, but there's a lot of overlap there.
Cytosis is a worker placement game that's located inside a human cell. You use your workers to collect resources like mRNA, ATP, lipids, and carbohydrates, and then you use them to produce enzymes, proteins, steroids, receptors, and more. The enzymes are easy to make. Proteins and steroids require a multi-step process to produce, which will have you using transport discs to move your resource cubes around the various parts of the cell.
Physically, this is all represented on the board, which is a giant, very colorful cell with very obvious worker placement spots and clear iconography. Resources are represented by different colored cubes and ATP, or energy. The currency of the game is represented by cardboard tokens. Workers are wooden vials, and card quality is excellent. Except for looking like a potentially dry educational game, we have no complaints component-wise. On the educational side, the game also comes with a description of actual cell functions and how they are represented in the game, a sort of teacher's guide.
So you start Cytosis by laying out the board. One side's used for 2 players, it has less worker placement spots on it. The other is for all player counts. Players collect the components in their color and keep a number of worker flasks based on the player count. A set of goal cards is drawn and displayed at the top of the board, and each player is dealt 2 cell component cards. They choose one to keep. Actually, it might be 3 and you keep 2. Sorry, I might be a little off on that one. Not too important right now. The remaining cell cards are placed next to the board, and the 4-card market at the bottom of the board is filled. An event deck is created, and each player gets some starting ATP based on the player order.
On your turn, you're going to use one of your worker flasks to claim a spot on the board and take the associated action. These actions include collecting resources, purchasing new cell component cards, completing cell component cards in your hand, and taking the first player marker, and also claiming a goal or 1 ATP. There's also a way to purchase an additional flask for 1 turn, which will give you an extra action.
So collecting resources is pretty simple. You place your worker and collect the amount of resources that are shown. Some spots require you to trade 1 resource for another, or to trade ATP for resources, or a resource for ATP.
Now, purchasing cards is also simple. Each spot in the market shows a cost, an ATP. Pay the cost, take the card. Note the cards do not refill when purchased, that you have to wait till the end of the round, and at that point, the leftmost card is actually discarded.
Taking the first player marker is simple enough. You go first next turn, but in addition to that, you get to place a goal marker on one of the available goal cards. Now, each goal card only has spots for 2 markers, and the player who claims the card first is going to get bonus points. The goals award end game points for collecting different things like protein cards, steroid receptors, specific cell cards, etc.
Well, that leaves the most complicated part of the game, and that is completing cell component cards. Some of these are simple. To complete an alcohol detoxification card, you just have to place a flask on the smoothie R and pay some energy. Enzymes are also pretty easy, as you place on the proper spot and trade in the resources shown.
Now, things get interesting with hormones. These include steroids, proteins, and receptors for both. Completing one of these is a multi-step purpose, which starts by placing in one of the 2 ER spots, either smooth or rough, placing your transport disc there and placing the appropriate resources on the disc. Then you need to place another worker on the Golgi apparatus and move your disc down to that spot and add some more needed resources there. Finally, you'll have to play a worker at the plasma membrane to actually play the card, which you pay its ATP cost. Note, this doesn't all have to be done on the same turn.
Man, I'm thinking this is sounding way more dry than it actually plays. Okay, every cell component card you complete gives you bonus points in the form of health. Alcohol cards are only worth 1 point, but there's bonus points at the end of the game for completing the most value of alcohol cards. Enzymes are worth a small amount of health, but you get bonus points at the end for having sets of different enzymes. Hormones give you big points, but also give points to any opponents who have already built receptors of the appropriate types.
At the end of each round, everyone collects their workers. The leftmost cell card is discarded and the market is refilled. Finally, an event card is flipped up. Each of these gives or provides a one-time bonus for one of the worker placement spots on the board, awarded to the first player who uses that spot. The game ends the round after you flip the last event card. The player with the most health wins.
And yeah, as Deanna just kind of said, this sounds a lot more complicated and dry than it actually is when you're playing on the table. Cytosis, a cell biology board game, is actually rather straightforward. Like, most actions are very clear and do one simple thing that's fully shown on the board how to do it. It's only when you get to the hormones that things get at all complicated. And honestly, if you played any engine building game before, even that's pretty straightforward.
And I'm going to disagree with the argument Sean made at the beginning that this has a very educational look to it, because to me, it didn't quite, like, it's a step up from the look of the average educational game. Like, just looking at this, you get the vibe that this is going to be actually a game of some enjoyment.
So I think the one detail people do need to remember and perhaps reinforce during the teach in that first gameplay is those goal cards. I know I was on the far end of the table from them, couldn't really read them easily. And since I was trying to keep track of the rest of things and learn my first time through the game, my score really suffered from not partaking in those goal cards.
Yeah, and to be fair, one of the more clever parts of this game is the way those goal cards work and how, through them, players will decide what they're scoring points for. You literally partway through the game are kind of like, well, I'm going to try to collect all this, or I'm going to work on that. The bonus points award for claiming these early on also kind of give you direction on what you should be doing next. To kind of give you an idea of what you should work towards and what you should be working on.
Yeah, I think in many ways, calling this an educational game is kind of doing it a disservice, as in the past, games under that sort of a title tended to be very light on the good game part. You either had an educational game or a fun game, and the more you learn from the game, the less fun the game was. Well, that's certainly changed now.
Yeah, and you were talking about the goal cards. I like the way that once you put your marker on there, you're showing everyone else at the table what you're going for, too, and that leads to some strategy.
Yeah, the most important thing, obviously, for people to know of this is it's a good game. Like, this is a very solid, well-play-tested, great flow, very solid worker placement game with a kind of interesting engine building mechanic. There's some set collection with the enzymes, and there's area majority even with the alcohol detoxification card. So, like, this is just, it's a solid cube pushing Euro. It fully fits. It just fits that genre game really well.
And the theme is really tightly tied in. Everything makes sense. The science educational aspects are really tied into the game mechanics. So everything just makes sense.
Yeah, and it's interesting. You know, when we're describing it and discussing it in this way, it does sound really dry, because mostly because of the big words, except you almost don't need them. Now, again, it is well tied to the theme. It's not just pasted on. They've taken it and done it well. But once you're playing the game, you can start thinking about, you know, colored cubes and things, and it makes it easier to play the game, which also makes it easier to learn what's going on. It's that mnemonic idea where you're connecting these big words on the cards with these really actually kind of simple actions that are happening on the board.
And I got to say, we're not using the big words here. We're sticking to the ER and ATP. We're not saying adenosine triphosphate every time we say ATP. So it does kind of simplify things a bit. And we're just talking about resources in general. But yes, the red cubes are one thing and the yellow cubes are another and the green cubes are another one. Yes, you definitely, I did find myself while playing this game doing the Lords of Waterdeep thing where I'm just, hand me two red cubes, please. Not, can you please pass me some mRNA, which is not the red cubes. Actually, it's the black cubes. Now, another thing I did like about this game is the fact it's a bit of a point salad, because while you can focus on like doing one thing, right? You can be like, oh, this game, I'm going to collect enzymes because I get all the enzymes for having a complete set. It's worth this many points. And then if I collect a second set, I can get this, and maybe I can get three sets going. Or you'd be like, no, you know what? I'm just going to build protein hormone receptors. And then every time someone else makes it, I'm going to get a ton of points. Or you're like, I'm going to buy every alcohol card that comes up. Well, the thing is, that works to a point. You can kind of set a goal like that. But due to the luck of the draw and the fact there's only four cards in the market every turn, you won't be able to just specialize in one thing. You're forced to do other stuff. Or if you don't, you're wasting turns doing nothing. Now, that said, this game does reward a level of game mastery and knowing the deck. So you are going to have an advantage if you played the game more than a new player, or if you haven't looked through the deck to kind of see the distribution.
Yeah, that's true, because I am the kind of player that usually tries to pick a path for my victory. Not always the same one. And I love that there's multiple paths to get there. But you can't pick a path in this and stay on it. You have to be adapting to the game situation as you go, and you are going to have to spread out to be able to get your points.
So one thing to be aware of this game, this can be quite cutthroat. This is a nasty worker placement game. You will be competing for spots. Some of the options of the board are limited, very limited, only allowing one player to use them in a five-player game. For example, there's one spot in the smooth endoplasmic reticulum, which is the start spot for trying to complete any steroid card. But it's also where you have to go for alcohol detoxification. So if you know you need to go to the smooth ER, you better steal a start player so that you can make sure to get there first. Because if anyone else is trying to do alcohol detoxification or produce steroids, they're going to steal the spot. Plus, when you are doing the whole building hormones thing, there's the whole thing where you're moving your transport disc. Well, there's only spots for so many discs on the board. And if you move to a spot where there's no room, the player who has the most health gets their disc back and loses all progress they've made on that hormone.
Yeah, that doesn't happen as often as I thought it would. The board feels tight, but at least in the place we had, we weren't actually kicking each other out.
Yeah, I do find in many ways, while it's very much not what we think of as an educational, it is kind of very much what you expect in a really solid, tight Euro game, which yep. is a staggering standout in the educational world.
Overall, I'll say it outright. This is the best educational game I played. It does a great job of being just abstract enough while still being true to the science, and it's actually quite fun. It's a very solid worker placement game and has engaging mechanics. The problem is that it is an educational game, and no matter how much we try to say it's better than it looks, it's better than it sounds, it is still kind of dry. It's kind of hard to get excited about producing proteins, and while the game works and works well, it just lacks that fun theme. And it doesn't really have any new mechanical twists or anything really different from previous games that makes it stick out, other than the fact that it's an actually fun educational game. While I enjoy Cytosis and will happily sit down and play it again, I can't see ever actually recommending this game on game night. And there's no way I'm calling up my friends for a night of pizza and Cytosis.
Though I will say our daughter, who is in eighth grade, actually really enjoyed the game, found it fun, and wanted to play again. So that's a good sign.
Yeah, I think the best way to describe this game would be as a solid, enjoyable midweight Euro that also teaches you about cell biology. It's a good game. It just happens to be very educational. I think, you know, it's really, as a Euro game, it's not that much more dry than, you know, building cheese in your local French, townships.
Now, of course, where I think this game is going to really shine is in the classroom. Though I personally don't want to figure out the logistics of playing a five-player game with 30 students. That's up to the curriculum to figure out, or the teachers or professors to figure out. Now, this was kind of funny because I went to double-check a rule this morning, and I searched online, and the first hit I found for this game was the University of Waterloo, which obviously uses the game for one of their courses. This is a game that you can learn something, though honestly, I think it's probably better as a mnemonic for remembering cell biology concepts that you originally learned in the classroom. Now, if you have tried this game and really dug it and would call up your friends for a pizza and Cytosis party, there is an expansion, the Cytosis Virus expansion. The expansion adds influenza, rhinovirus, and Ebola, and the ability to spend ATP to build up antibodies to combat each of these strains. It adds dice, new mechanics, additional cards, and more to Cytosis.
That actually sounds kind of interesting. And then there is actually also a plant cell game that Genius Games puts out, but we didn't find that out until later because I think our daughter would have been even more interested in that one because that is exactly what she was studying in school at the time. But I can't remember the name of that one.
Yeah, actually, the designer of this is actually a PhD student in public health with a master's in environmental and chemical engineering. So there's some smart folks making this game. So that's all we have time for tonight's class. Your homework, which is due on my desk by the start of class tomorrow, is to leave a comment on this review, wherever you found it, and let us know what your favorite educational game is.
And don't forget our class fundraiser, where you can support your Tabletop Bellhop classmates through their Patreon. Get access to crib notes for each show, first thought, game reviews, bonus audio, and more. Show your team spirit at patreon.com/tabletopbellhop.
Well, that was the double bell.
That means our shift's coming to an end and we're going to have to lock the lobby doors.
Before we start locking things down, let's take a moment to thank a selection of our awesome Tabletop Bellhop Patreon patrons.
Danielle and Owen Thomas, thank you.
Sean Pete Kelly, thanks, Sean.
Derek Hissen, thank you, Derek.
Thanks to the members of the Misdirected Mark podcast.
Donna, thank you to our personal paladin.
Evil John, thank you, John.
Your first stop to finding us should be at tabletopbellhop.com, but we're all over the web as Tabletop Bellhop, one word, and on your podcatcher of choice as the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
Help spread the word about our podcast by sporting some awesome Tabletop Bellhop merch. We've got golf shirts, t-shirts, mugs, and more. Just head to tabletopbellhop.com/merch. Buy two items and use the code TABLETOP to save on shipping.
If you enjoyed this episode, be sure to subscribe on Spotify or Apple Podcasts or wherever you listen. And please tell your friends and fellow gamers about our show. That's it for tonight.
For the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast, I'm Sean.
I'm Deanna.
And I'm Mo.
Thank you.
And
game on.